Good evening. Welcome to this session, which is titled Treating Complex Coronary Lesions, Right Case, Right Time, Prevail Drug-Coated Balloon, brought by Medtronic as the sponsor. Now, the objective of this talk would be to reflect on the latest information on Prevail Drug-Coated Balloon and study, to gain insights through cases using Prevail Drug-Coated Balloon, and to explore drug-coated balloon technology and learn the expert recommended indications. For today, we will have Dr. Frankie Tam Chow Chung from Queen Mary Hospital, University of Hong Kong. He will be presenting the Prevail 12-month study in real-world practice, my Prevail cases. And then we will follow with some questions for him. Following that, we'll have the second speaker, which is Dr. Ong Tiong Kiam from Sarawak General Hospital, Malaysia. And Dr. Ong will be talking about when is the best time to use drug-coated balloons, with also some questions following that. And after that, it will be a wrap-up by me.
Thanks for having me here. So it's my pleasure to be here to share my Prevail cases. So I'm Dr. Frankie Chan from Hong Kong. So I think most of you agree with that nowadays, the advancement of technology, we have different techniques and various devices so that we can treat diseases that we cannot treat before. And out of all the devices, I think most of you will agree that the drug-coated balloon is very powerful. It emerges to be a very important tool to tackle our increasingly complex patients and anatomy. And I'm going to share with you that the superior deliverability of the Prevail DCB and the favorable results of the Prevail registry actually empowers us to use this as a very powerful weapon in complex PCI. So let me tell you the use of DCB in my clinical practice. In my opinion, DCB is particularly useful in the following three scenarios. The first is in-stent restenosis, particularly if you want to avoid another layer of stent. For example, if you want to reduce the chance of major sideband compromise in sideband stent previously gelled by a stent with ISR. Also, nowadays, we are doing more complex two-stent strategy. If those patients come back with ISR, we don't want to put in another stent again. Also, for de novo small vessel disease, particularly if the vessel is long and diffuse disease with tortuous, we don't want to put in a stent in there. We can allow the vessel to be moderate after PCI, and sometimes we can preserve the target for CABG if the patient is very young. The first scenario is exploratory. In my opinion, sometimes the use of DCP can reduce the rate of a complex bifurcation to stenting. Okay, let me share with you my real Prevail case. So the first case is a case of in-stent restenosis. It's a 79-year-old male with history of diabetes, hypertension, and history of PCI to approximately a 2.5 millimeter taxus many years ago. This time, he complained of stable angina. His symptom is stable, and the echo shows normal every year. So these are the angiograms. We can see the LAD is calcified with stenosis in the proximal LAD. And actually, the stenosis is an ISR. The proximal LAD stent covers the big diagonal one. So in this case, we first do some physiology. We perform an IFR, which is positive, and 0.84, with major step up at the osteo LAD, proximal LAD stent, and the stent outlet. So we want to do PCI, and then we think that for stent failure, imaging is very important. In this case, we use IFUS, which showed a previous stent under expansion because of extrinsic calcium. We know that this proximal LAD is just a 2.5 millimeter taxus stent. So in steep stent and expansion, I think shockwave IVL is very useful. So we use a 3.0x12 shockwave balloon. And after the shockwave, you can see that the balloon expansion is much, much better. But now, what should we do? So this is after the shockwave. Now we have an ISR. What should we do? Should we put two long DES? So in this case, I think a DCP DES hybrid strategy is very appropriate. So we use the DCP to treat the ISR, particularly at the site of a big diagonal. We use 2DES to treat the in-segment ISR. So by this, we can minimize the length of the stent overlap and try to preserve the big diagonal side branch. So this is the final result. You can see very good result, and the diagonal flow is TB-free. So now the second case is the case of small vessel and side branch disease. So this is a 71-year-old male, smoker, diabetes, and hypertension. This time, he actually admitted for in-stent. He's stable, but the LVEF is just around 40% with hypokinesia and LAD charge. So this is the angiogram. You can see this is a total pop in the mid-LAD with a diffuse disease and possibly a CTO in the diagonal tube. You can see that again, very, very diffuse disease in the diagonal tube. So in this case, we first wire the LAD with the root host wire, and then we try to wire the diagonal with a 3DXTA with the support of a dual catheter, which is quite easy. You can see the wire just goes through easy. And this is after to poke wire and do some pullback. You can see vertex stenosis in the LAD and also the diagonal very diffuse disease and tortuous with small vessel size. And most of that, should we do professional stenting? Should we do upfront two stent? If you want to stand a diagonal, where will you land the diagonal to stand? So again, in cases like this, I think a DES and DCB hybrid strategy is appropriate. So in this case, you stand the main LED with two DES, and we do prevail DCB in the diagonal. So 1.2.0.20 prevail DCB in the middle distal diagonal, and 1.3.0.20 DCB in the proximal diagonal. So this is the final result. Very nice TB-free flow, and the diagonal seems well. In this case, we are going to do a complex student strategy in this LAD diagonal bifurcation. So this is the gentleman. In conclusion, in modern PCI, we have better tools and technique to tackle increasingly complex anatomy and patients. And I think DCB emerges to be a very valuable tool to treat complex disease. And I think DCB is particularly useful in cases of RSL, small diffuse disease, and possibly bifurcation lesion. So thank you very much.
Dr. Tam, that was a great case sharing that you had when both cases were done successfully with a drug-coated balloon. If I may ask you, why did you use in particular the Prevail balloon DCB for this case?
So I think nowadays we use the Prevail DCB because it is very different. So we know that we are using the Euphora cervical pump balloon for a long time. It's a very nice balloon which track easily, even in very tortuous lesions or even full stent struts. So in cases like my cases, so those cases are quite challenging, particularly is the small diagonal which full LAD stent strut. In that case, using a Prevail DCB, we deliver the balloon with not much difficulty. So I think the Prevail DCB is very, very useful. And also because of the very nice result of the Prevail DCB study, so it actually gives us confidence to use DCB in complex cases like the cases I showed by to you.
How does the latest Prevail study result change your practice in complex PCI? Can you tell us?
Yeah, so actually as one of the investigators in the Prevail DCB study, so I remember during the study, because of the study protocol, we just dared to use the Prevail DCB in the usual, very standard DCB cases, for example, big ISR or very focal, de novo diseases. But after we see the results, that Prevail DCB is very encouraging, particularly in the de novo cases, that actually the vessel remodels and the MMA actually increased in the resulting coronary angiogram compared to the post PCI angiogram. So nowadays, I think using this Prevail DCB, we can treat lesions which are much more complex that we did not use it in the previous study. So again, it's a very nice result. I can extend to use the Prevail DCB in complex cases or push the device to the push the boundary to use that in the more complex cases.
So you think there will be advantages of the use of DCB in complex PCI?
Yes, so as I showed my slide, so nowadays we have more in complex cases, particularly in use of ISR or even ISR after the complex two-stent stenting, for example, and ISR after a decade brush. So I think most of you will agree that in those cases, we really don't want to put another stent anymore. So I think DCB gives us a very important chance to use that to treat those lesions. And I think that's a very important message for all of us.
Thank you, Dr. Frankie Tam.
Now I'm going to just talk briefly about when is the best time to use a drug-coated balloon. And well, there are several ways to approach this question. Firstly, you can just follow the recommendations in the guidelines or the consensus statements, or, you know, but there are many, these are just guidelines and consensus statements, right? But there are many uses beyond what is recommended in this in the guidelines. So I think it's easy to think of it in this manner, as you can see in the slide, right? I would think of using a DCB when I want to avoid using a stent, right? That's fairly straightforward. So when would that be? That would be in situations where, for instance, I have a high bleeding risk patients with malignancies going for surgery. So now these are patients where I would really don't want to have any foreign matter inside the patient. And this would be the situation where I would be thinking of using a drug-coated balloon. The other situation is when the patient has in-stent restenosis. And this is interesting because one of the indications for DCB is in-stent restenosis. However, if you have in-stent restenosis in a small vessel, a 2.5 millimeter vessel, for instance, I think to put in a second layer of stent would, you know, really compromise the lumen diameter for that patient. Even in a larger vessel, if the patient had a previous ISR and had a second layer of stent, I would be very reluctant to put in a third layer of stent. And so that's the situations where a drug-coated balloon would be perfect. The other situation will be complex, right? Complex. Actually, drug-coated balloons are ideal for treatment of complex lesions. It can really help you convert a complex into a simple PCI so that you don't, for instance, in bifurcation or trifurcations, instead of putting in two layers or three stents or two stents, now you can just end up with a single stent or no stent at all. So it's really ideal for complex lesions, with the exception perhaps of left main stem, right? But that is again debatable. So this, we would use a drug-coated balloon when you want to avoid a stent, but we'd also consider a drug-coated balloon if you do not need to use a stent. So after adequate lesion preparation, and you get a good result after lesion preparation, you have less than 30% residual stenosis, you have good flow, you know, if you're not sure, you can do an FFR, and if that's greater than 0.8, and the patient does not have severe dissections or type A or type B, dissections are acceptable. So if all those properties or result after lesion preparation, then there's no reason really to put in a stent, and you can really get away with just a drug-coated balloon. And sometimes, you know, this is the patient coming back for stage procedure, and if the patient had been treated with a drug-coated balloon in a different vessel previously, and you have had a good result, and that will make me more inclined to use a drug-coated balloon in subsequent PCIs on the same patient. Of course, we have to also remember when not to use a drug-coated balloon, right? So if the result after lesion preparation is suboptimal, right, and we have, you know, significant residual stenosis and the flow is not good, or you have a bad type C dissection, even worse, then you know, we should not persevere with a drug-coated balloon strategy and convert to a stenting strategy. Sometimes we have a patient who has been treated with a drug-coated balloon before and come back with very bad risk stenosis. Then, and sometimes they have it done a few times and come back again multiple times with risk stenosis. Then these are the patients where I would not persevere with a DCB strategy. Of course, you can argue that if you had done the previous procedure with paclitaxel DCB, maybe you can try again with a limus, sirolimus DCB, and whether that will give us a different result or not. And as I mentioned before, left main is a different kettle of fish. And at the moment, there's very little data for left main intervention. And probably drug-coated balloons should be used very selectively for left main intervention. So in my opinion, that's how I would use a drug-coated balloon for PCI.
Thank you, Dr. Ong. A great presentation with very concise points here. which type of drug would you consider for DCB? And I know that we have started off with paclitaxel, and you also mentioned that we have other types of drug like sirolimus. Now, why do we choose paclitaxel? Is there any data saying which one is better?
Well, the paclitaxel drug-coated balloons have been around for a long time. So there's a lot of experience and we have a lot of data on paclitaxel drug-coated balloons. And because of the properties, the lipophilic and hydrophobic properties of the drug, then it seems to be the ideal drug to use, you know. But people have been keen to try sirolimus drug-coated balloon or to use sirolimus coated balloon because of our experience with the drug-eluting stent. The limus coated stent seems to do better than the taxel stents, right? And which is why recently now we have been getting into the market more and more sirolimus coated balloons. But however, if you look at the results of their studies, the comparison of the sirolimus versus the taxel drug-coated balloons, they're at best short equivalent, all right? I don't think there's been any limus coated balloon that's been shown to be superior to a paclitaxel balloon. So I think the answer is to use the balloon that you're familiar with. It probably does not matter which one you choose.
Thank you. And lastly, what are the difference between different kinds of available drug-coated balloon in the market?
Well, other than the drug, it appears that not all drug-coated balloons are the same, right? The carrier, right, is the excipient, the carrier seems to make a difference to the outcome. So I think if any of us is thinking of using a drug-coated balloon and is choosing between the many, many types that's available in the market now, I think it's important to look at the data and the trials that have been done. And to be sure that the balloons perform as what is they are supposed to perform, because they are not all the same. Yeah. So I'll choose really based on available data. And of course, as you start experimenting with these balloons and try different types of balloons, eventually you find that not all of them behave the same in terms of deliverability. And so some are better than others. Then the choice will be on those balloons that's more easy to deliver.
Thank you, Dr. Tam and Dr. Ong, for great lectures. So we have heard from our two speakers on the PREVAIL study and the latest information about the drug-coated balloon. Dr. Tam has shown us two great cases, complex cases, which he has used that and give us the confidence of using this new balloon with a better profile compared to the older balloon. And Dr. Ong has also shared with us the indications for drug-coated balloon and how he feels that the drug-coated balloon can be used for other indications out of the EIC 2018 recommendation for in-stent restenosis. We have seen how both the speakers have considered using that in more complex lesion with very good results. So with that, we would like to thank everybody as well as the sponsors who have allowed this session to happen. Thank you very much.